it's Michael J., and I wanted to talk about silent movies, but the subject is too comprehensive for a little video like this, so I thought I'd just show you my favorite things about silent movies, and one of them is going to see them live.
The best place to see silent films in New York is the Film Forum. It began in 1970, but this current location was built in 1989. It's the only nonprofit cinema in New York, and it's one of few in the country. It specializes in independent films, and they show a lot of silent films. And tonight, they're going to show Harold Lloyd in The Freshman. You know Harold Lloyd because of his glasses, and even if you've never seen one of his movies, you know him from this famous clock scene from the film Safety Last. Buster Keaton always had this funny blank expression. It was part of his shtick. And he worked a lot of years. He worked into the late 1960s.
Pass.
Three, no Trump.
Pass. Pass.
Buster Keaton's comedy had a lot to do with huge sets and props as part of his comedy. And he was very physical. A lot of the silent movie comedians were very physical because they had to show you everything they were doing. They didn't have dialogue. So even like Harold Lloyd, who's a romantic comedian, was very physical. Of course, Charlie Chaplin is the king and one of my idols, and his physical comedy is absolutely amazing. But he also had a lot of heart to him. There was a serious side. When I was 15 years old, I made my own silent movie. I made my own version of Charlie Chaplin's The Kid, and I filmed it in black and white. And I did a lot of things in it that I thought had to be in a silent movie, like a pie fight and the Keystone Cops. This is from Charlie Chaplin's The Kid. His serious films were always great, always full of comedy, but there was the pathos there too, which is what I think makes him so endearing. And this is little Jackie Coogan here pleading. Jackie Coogan, who went on to become Uncle Fester in the Addams Family. I love the imagery of the silent films. The cameras would swoop around, there'd be these big scenes, there'd be long lingering shots on the stars, and you'd really see what was going on behind their eyes. There would be these big scenes full of airplanes and thousands of extras, and all of this stuff was done for real. There wasn't green screen here, there weren't a lot of special effects. There was also a lot of poetry. Like this scene with the table. I wish somebody would do something like that in a movie today. It's so beautiful. The movies could be dreamlike and surreal, and so I think that sometimes they're very frightening. This is Fritz Lang's Metropolis and his vision of the futuristic world. Look at this crazy composite shot from Fritz Lang's Metropolis. Amazing. And this scene where the water is flooding into the building and it's chaos. It's very exciting. I love the big, big old stars. Like here's Mary Pickford, America's sweetheart, and she got married to Douglas Fairbanks, who was the big swashbuckling hero before Errol Flynn came along. And of course, Rudolph Valentino, the big, hunky, romantic leading man. He really was a fashion icon as well. Men wanted to comb their hair like his and wear clothes like his. He's in a lot of costume dramas, so he played a lot of exotic characters. And this tango scene is really important to history because it's because of this scene that dancing the tango became a cliche of the 1920s. John Gilbert and Greta Garbo, and she looks so marvelous in the silent movies. Louise Brooks and Lulu set fashion standards with her hair, and also Clara Bow, the It Girl herself, with her bobbed hair. One of my very favorite silent films from 1927 is Wings. It was the first to win the Academy Award. It actually tied with the movie Sunrise. It was directed by William Wellman, and it stars Buddy Rogers, Richard Arlen, and the It Girl herself, Clara Bow. It's about two best friends in love with the same girl, and it's during World War I, and it has these fantastic airplane sequences. And folks, this is not green screen. This is not special effects. Well, there's some special effects in here, obviously, but they're getting this in camera with cameras attached to the airplanes flying around and making these fights up. It really is marvelous. My other very favorite dramatic film is The Crab from 1928, directed by King Vidor. It has this wonderful actor that we're going to focus in on here, James Murray. And the leading lady in it is Eleanor Boardman. These two people only acted somewhere into the mid-1930s. But this is a simple little domestic tale of a couple and how they meet and their marriage and what they go through in the context of the big world of a metropolis and a big crowd. And he meets her on a blind date, and they hit it off immediately. I love this sequence because it shows you old Coney Island, and you get to see a lot of the old rides and them having a good time. And I like the way this sequence is cut together, and it's really interesting. There's interesting camera angles, interesting ways of showing how much fun the group is having. The sequence is as much fun to watch as it looks like the actors are having fun doing it. And right after the first date, they're in love, and he asks her to marry her. And I love her reaction because she says yes, and then all of a sudden she has kind of a double take, and she thinks, oh my God, what am I getting myself into? I like how realistic this movie is. It shows them going through their struggles. He doesn't make a lot of money, and they're living in a small apartment, and they kind of get sick of each other and have fights. Then there's this wonderful moment when she tells him that she's pregnant. He realizes he's going to have a child, and it makes everything better. And then we go back to the theme of the crowd, which keeps coming back. There are always these scenes where this little story is suddenly dwarfed by the bigness of the world they live in. And here's this gigantic hospital. I mean, what hospital looks like that and has this room? This is poetry. It's symbolic. And so there are these rows and rows of beds with women who are pregnant, and he has to find his wife out of all of these people. And so they have a pair of kids, and they're really cute, but there's a tragic situation that happens. The dad really can't take it that he lost a child, and it sort of ruins his life. And he loses his job, and the wife kicks him out, and he thinks he'd be better off dead, so he thinks about committing suicide. But he doesn't do it because he realizes he has this little boy to raise. And the little boy inspires him to go on. He realizes that he's loved and needed, and that he has a responsibility to this child. And with new resolve, he goes off to mend his marriage, and the film ends with this nice scene of them enjoying an evening with the family at a vaudeville show with everybody laughing. It's a great ending. This is one of my favorite moments in all of silent film. It is Lon Chaney in The Phantom of the Opera. Look at that. Horrifying. I love her reaction. Ah! I mean, you would scream too if you saw that. This is everybody's nightmare. The author Ray Bradbury talked about this movie all through his career. He saw it when he was a little boy, and it made such a big impression on him. And why wouldn't it? You see this thing. This is my favorite scene coming up as he walks towards the camera here in a close-up. Look at that. That is a nightmare.
Look at them in the front offices. The masterminds. They took the idols and smashed them. The Fairbankses, the Gilberts, the Valentinos.
Gloria Swanson was a silent movie star who made a big comeback in 1950 in Sunset Boulevard. Just writing.
You are. Writing words. Words. More words. Well, you've made a rope of words and strangled this business.
Charlie Chaplin would have agreed with that statement. Charlie Chaplin was really the last holdout. He wanted to keep making silent films even though everybody had gone over to sound. And he felt like his little tramp character would be ruined if he ever talked, and that that would be at the end of him. But he started to incorporate sound in some of his films, and he does a really great job in films like Modern Times, and uses sound effects and sounds really well, but he doesn't talk. He also composed the score for this, and out of this came the song Smile, which has been recorded by absolutely everybody who's a major singer. It's a beautiful song, one of my favorite songs. The song Smile is one of the things I love most about the silent movies.
Light of your face with gladness, hide every trace of sadness, although a tear may be ever so near. That's the time you must keep on trying. Life is still worthwhile if you just smile.